President Mahama, 900,000 followers on Facebook. Nana Akufo-Addo, 700,000. You are number three, 200,000.
Well, you know, it's interesting because back in 2012, I had a lot more than the rest of them. Okay.
Okay.
But others caught up and felt that the likes, that's what they are looking for. And it's okay to have many likes, but it is what you do with it that is important. Okay. I have content, better content, which I put there myself, not some social media person. I do it myself. I put the content there. I think about the content. So you, if you go to my page, you will find that it has meaningful content, not just hello, hi, I'm here, I'm there, but what is it? What do we want to do about education? What do we want to do about jobs? And I write, and then we spread it. And you will find that consistently, we have over 100,000 people who get to see those things, who get to use them, and many media people pick them up, and it goes far.
So that's why you sometimes put your official views on running stories.
Absolutely.
And everything. Managing it yourself, because it's going to get bigger.
But I've done it since 2012. Okay, the point is that who better to put there directly what is it that I am thinking? It's me. Mm-hmm. Yes, I have people who help me and they do other things for me. Mm. But when it comes to that page, I dream of the content. I put it there. I make sure it's correct. Most of the tweets, someone does them.
Okay.
But the Facebook
you do it yourself.
That I do it myself.
I see. That's interesting. Let me talk a bit about some of your companies. So I have I went to your latest acquisition, ISF Bank in Illinois, which you are board chairman of. And this is true. All these are companies you either founded or own.
Yes, we there are a number of enterprises that we have started, and what you have mentioned, they exist. But most importantly, what we have tried to do is to find the best men and women available who can help us get started in certain industries. It's not everything that we will do. Some things come up and we help other people to start and to run. Some of them we do ourselves, and those are some of the ones that you are.
Oh, so there's more than what I have on the list.
Yes, there's some that we help other people to do, and it's our practice.
Okay.
Is to help other people to finance their business, mm-hmm. To run their business. Recently, there's a company called Hortz. Hortz produces brown gold, the chocolate product, the cocoa product, brown gold.
Yeah.
It is a small company. They needed financial help, technical help. It is not one of our companies, but we have pushed them, invested in it, and are helping so that it can become big and powerful, because the raw material is cocoa, which we have in Ghana.
So it means if we put all that together, you may be into over 100.
Yeah, but I don't count those
them
ones.
Them as
no, they are not our companies. They are companies we are helping launch.
You give them funding
to work. But it is important that we have companies like ours, and I pray for other people so that they can also build big, powerful, financially strong companies that can last from generation to generation. That is the only way that a country can prosper. So we're now in the US into banking. You know, quite often we sit here in Ghana and we say, oh, we want a foreign investor to come from the US, from France, from the UK. Well, we have also learned the art and the specialty of taking money and our expertise from here to go somewhere else, participate in their economy, so that we can bring benefits, the dividends, here to Ghana. If we bring dollars from America to Ghana, or dollars from Liberia to Ghana, we are strengthening our seas.
But that's interesting, because generally, when you speak to bankers, they'll tell you that all the money is supposed to move to Africa and the emerging markets, because the banking sector in the Western world has flattened out. So I'm quite surprised that Group Indom thought it necessary to buy a bank in the US.
Because even in the small area where that bank is, we did a survey, and the opportunity that is there for deposits is over $2 billion. Can you imagine? if we can even achieve half of what we believe is possible, so we can have $1 billion in deposits. $1 billion in deposits is bigger than what any bank in Ghana today has. Okay, but now we do that there. We take our Ghanaians there to gain experience. We bring back dollars as dividend back to Ghana. It strengthens our city. So we are doing and demonstrating to people that we are truly as blessed as anybody else in this world. All we are looking for is opportunity. And what I am offering to Ghanaians is that how we have done these things, the route we have followed, the discipline we have used, that is the same discipline we will use in managing the affairs of this country.
Over which period did you start these companies? Because these are, some of them are very, very large indeed. How long, which one is the oldest, for example?
Well, if you take Coconut Grove, mm-hmm. Okay, Coconut Grove has been there for more than 22 years. Gold Coast has been there also for more than 22 years. So the oldest is about 25 years. So it has taken us about 30 years of planning and thinking to get to where we are. So we didn't just start yesterday. GN Bank is 10 years this year, okay? And we started with the same objective. Our objective is, having studied Ghana, having studied African countries, we realize that the small local economies that we have around the country, they will not progress unless they have a reputable, regulated financial institution everywhere. And that is what we set out to do. That our target is to make sure that wherever you are in Ghana, you should be within a 1 or 2, a maximum 5 mile radius from a GN Bank, which means about 300 locations throughout the country, so that wherever somebody is, they can put their money somewhere safely and there'll be somebody to give them financial advice. So that is what we're trying to do.
You made a very interesting point about talent. So what if I said to you that it's very evident from what you've done that your actual talent is starting businesses and getting people employed? Because if I compare your business success to your political success, they are very, very contrasting. So if I said to you, Doc, why don't you just stay within your talent field? As you said to me, I should remain in my media, and you said somebody should do law. Your talent, very evidently, is creating business in the private sector and doing it spectacularly well. So why are you bothering yourself?
When you say in the private sector,
because all your businesses are private sector owned businesses.
Yes, but it's in Ghana.
Yes,
but you see, sometimes
so that's your field.
Well, sometimes people don't understand that I have contested election as an assembly member and won, contested election to go to parliament and won. The presidential one is what has eluded me so far. My point is that if we have a job to be done in Ghana, okay, it's not a popularity contest. You see, I heard one of the people that I respect here in the Ben Efson. I guess he was on some radio, and he said, "Oh, Bakusi, he can't win." I would like to ask Mr. Ben Efson to stop that sort of argument. We have reached a point in Ghana where we should begin to talk about competency, ability. Can this person do the job or not? You are sitting where you are because you've been judged to be the best person to sit there by the owners of this company. It's not because you started off as being the most popular person. If you own a store and you want an accountant to sit there and count your money for you every day, you don't go around town and find the most popular person to come and put there. You want the best person, the one who has the accounting skill, to come and do that job for you. And it's the same way in Ghana. Sometimes in Ghana, people say, "Oh, Papa, no way, Fe. Papa, oh, Tintin. Papa, you're short. You're to them. No. Who has the right ability, the right competency, the right experience to match up to the problem we have today? That's why I say to Ghanaians that at Gold Coast time, when we needed political independence, there were lawyers around, there were business people around, there were all sorts of people around. But it took Kwame Nkrumah, the one who had gone to learn from other people who were agitating for black liberation and so on and so forth, Marcus Garvey and so on and so forth in the US and elsewhere. He had learned the power of oratory and convincing people. He had the talent for the time. and his talent, he applied successfully.
Yeah. So let me stretch you further on this, because look, when we look at even the Ghana example, so there was Park Grant who had the money, and then Nkrumah had the political talent, if you like. So Grant started the UGCC, got the politicians to work together. Even if you go to the US, the past few presidents they've had, they've not been business people. Obama is a great lawyer. I mean, there are people in America who have business acumen, but just give me a few examples. So even in the developed world, David Cameron and all these guys, these are your lawyer types, your communication types, and usually the business people like you support them from behind, or they take on special projects. So it's not very common to have a successful entrepreneur with such great business concerns.
But you are wrong.
Enter the field.
No, but you are wrong.
So give me an example.
I'm saying to you, you are wrong. See,
give me the evidence.
Every season.
I've given you examples.
Yeah, but
so give me the evidence.
Allow me also to make my point.
Good.
Because what I'm trying to tell you is that every situation calls for the right person. That's why I started off by citing Kwame Nkrumah. That the kind of person that he was, we needed him at the time we wanted political independence. This is the time we need economic independence. Okay? We need economic independence. And you need someone who has the knowledge, who has the expertise, who has the experience to be able to solve this financial problem that we have. I'm also giving you an example. Go back to 1992 election. We brought an airman. Okay, J.J. Rawlings, all right, and what happened? The economy, it did well a little bit, and then it tanked, it went bad. Then we went and got a lawyer, J.A. Kufuor, he came. The economy did well for the first 3 years or so. Then it also went down. Then we went and got another lawyer tax expert, the late Atta Mills. He also came. It looked like it was going to do okay, and then do so and other things came. And then we went and got the communicator. He also has come. And he, as for him, he had decided that this economy is beyond him. Let's give it to the IMF. Okay? So consistently, the economy has gone up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. Isn't it about time that we find the right person with the right expertise to say, let's hand this economy to this individual, and then let's see what is it that we can do? You give me examples of America and so on and so forth.
Yes.
If you go back to all of those other places in America, you will find over time the people who have come with a certain expertise and certain talent, because either they were in war times and they needed someone who had that expertise. Where the economy wasn't doing well, they needed someone who had a certain expertise. And so you will find over time the people who have come, and they have chalked decades and centuries to get to a situation where now they can say, okay, all that we need is maybe a little tweaking of the economy or the mentality of people or whatever. So now Obama can come and say, yes, we can. Even Trump can now say, we'll make America great again, and so on and so forth. They have gone through their really bad times when they were in a depression in America. It took financial people to help America get over it. We have reached that stage.